So we're in one, no we're not, in one, we're in Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. Got a bit of a cold, so bear with me. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honour thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. Liz tells me today that Melissa has totally changed her life, that she now is the best girl in the world, never plays her mother up, good child. All because of the word of God and the sermon. Thank you. Proceed. 4. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, dads, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Servants, be obedient to them that are your masters. Donna? According to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in the singleness of your heart, as unto Christ. Not with eye service, as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. With good will, doing service as to the Lord and not to men. Knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. And ye masters, do the same things unto them, forbearing threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven, neither is there respect of persons with him. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armour of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Therefore take unto you the whole armour of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly, to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak, but that ye also may know my affairs and how I do. Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that ye might know our affairs, and that he might comfort your hearts. Peace be to the brethren, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all them that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. Great chapter. We're picking up from verse 11, and really we probably class this as part two from last time. We went backwards a little bit last time, so we're going to hopefully cover it a little bit better today from the start. Put on the whole armour of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Well, we looked at the wiles of the devil last week, and a lot of us got convicted by that. And God willing, we had a better week in the Lord because of the preaching of the word. That's what it does. It convicts us, it encourages us, it challenges us to walk more godly in Christ Jesus. And we had some good testimony to that last week. So here, verse 10 to 20... what we've just read is a passage on spiritual warfare. Now, this is where the Pentecostals go crazy. I'm not going to go into all that today. We may touch upon a few things, we'll see. I'm going to show you something after. I won't put that on CD, but one nut who's got a massive following on the internet, some Pentecostal nut speaking so-called in tongues, and I'll show you something funny in regard to that. But here, spiritual warfare. Our leader is a captain. Turn to Hebrews chapter 2. Is a captain. We need to be led, and we need a good leader. And we've got the best leader you can get, and he's a captain. Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. For it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Our Lord Jesus Christ is the captain of our salvation. And this captain is a man of war. Sure, he came, you want to turn to Exodus 15. He came as a lamb the first time, the Passover lamb. This time he's coming back as the lion of the tribe of Judah. He's a man of war. Exodus 15, verse 3. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. He's coming back as a man of war. And whose troops must endure hardness. My little budding artist, Banksy Melissa, drew the soldier on the board for us. A soldier. Turn to 2 Timothy 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. So we have a captain, he's a man of war, we are his troops, and we need to endure hardness. That's what a soldier needs to do. I couldn't even imagine what it would have been like to go through World War II and some of the battles and fights that they went to, especially when reading about and watching the thing on Bastogne, when it was absolutely freezing there, and they were trying to survive and hold their ground. I couldn't even imagine. Talk about a soldier and the hardness of a true soldier. Incredible what they went through. So we must endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. We fight. 2 Timothy 4, 2 Timothy 4, verse 7. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. We need to fight. There's not many Christians fighting today. A lot of Christians are fighting among the ranks today, fighting each other on YouTube and all that tosh, but they're not fighting what they should be fighting. They're not fighting the enemy. They're fighting among themselves because they're cowards. They won't get out there. They're not true soldiers of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth, 2 Timothy 2, 3, 2 Timothy 2, 4. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. If you're entangled with the affairs of this life, in business, in entertainment, in sport, making money, buying houses, if you're entertainment, you're not a true soldier of Jesus Christ. You're a backslider. You're a coward. You haven't got a clue what the battle's all about, the war's about. You have no idea. You're an onlooker. I know lots of Christians that aren't true soldiers of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life. That's what the Bible says. That he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. I wonder what your affections are on. The world or doing what God wants. And then in verse 10 we read that, didn't we? Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. We went through that. Verse 11, now we talk about the armour of this soldier. The armour that is described is that of a Roman foot soldier. That's our picture behind us. On the board. We mentioned last week, and it's so true, you can't get enough Christians to sing Onward Christian Soldiers today because most of them are conscientious objectors. That is so true. The church is full of cowards. Conscientious objectors rather than standing and fighting. Today the church and colleges, Bible colleges, aren't producing soldiers. They produce executives. Children's workers, storytellers, effeminate pastors, cell group leaders. When was the last time you met a person that resembled a Christian soldier, a true soldier of Jesus Christ, someone that's all and out for the Lord? A soldier needs to be brave. He needs to be able to take a stand. He needs to be able to hold his ground, not get trampled on. Turn to 1 Peter 5. That's what they were doing in Bastogne. They were just holding their ground. 1 Peter 5, verse 8 and 9. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Are you taking a stand? Or are you one of these conscientious objectors, a coward? And even as a soldier, you'll get scared, but you'll still fight. Of course we get scared. Every soldier gets scared. You'd be mad not to. We're human beings. 2 Samuel 10 verse 12. Be of good courage and let us play the men for our people and for the cities of our God, and the Lord do that which seemeth him good. You read the account of Latimer and Ridley, who were being burnt at the stake, and one says to the other, play the man. Play the man. Sometimes we have to play the man. Do it. So we fight, and we keep fighting, and we'll keep fighting till the rapture. It's not about joining and tolerance and all that kind of stuff. It's about fighting. We're in a battle. We're fighting. Our captain's leading us. He's going to come and take us out of here soon, but we hold the ground. We stand. We fight. If we can go forward, we keep pushing forward, and we fight against the wiles of the devil, something we looked at last week. And isn't it amazing that the first attack the devil makes is regarding what? God's word. God's word. And people don't think that's significant, and people don't think that's important. That is pinnacle. We're going to see that in a second. So go back to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. So we put on armor, a metal covering, it says, defined in the word, a metal covering worn to protect the body in battle. We've just read that our battle is not with flesh and blood. No, we don't have to put on this big suit of heavy chainmail, but spiritually speaking, we do. When you go to war, you go prepared. You don't just you join the army, and then within a couple of days, they send you on the front line. There's months of training. We have people here, isn't it? Remember that guy who went for the Marines but didn't make the course? It was too tough for him. There's a lot of people that go through these courses, but they just don't make it. It's too tough. Being a soldier, you want to join the Marines, or you want to join the SAS or something like that, they'll push you to your limit. They'll break you. They'll do everything they can to break you. And some of us have never been at that stage in our lives where we've been broken. But some of us maybe have. It's very interesting when you talk to people that have been in the army, seen combat. But when you go to war, you go prepared. And you put on the whole armor of God. The whole armor of God. It's pointless going with just part armor. It's pointless going without the right equipment. Imagine going into battle unprepared. And most Christians are like this. Let's face the fact. We're talking about Christian soldiers. This is, you know, it's using the analogy of the soldier here. And this picture of a true soldier. And the Christian is meant to be like him. And yet, man alive, we call ourselves Christian soldiers and we'll leave church because of a frosty atmosphere. We leave church because somebody says something that somebody else, that you call that soldier. Your children, your babies, you're pathetic. People leave here, pathetic. Can't hack it. They're not soldiers. They're not even conscientious objectors. Imagine going into battle unprepared. Let alone having or not having the right gear. Imagine going into war, not having a helmet. You think that's important? Imagine having the wrong gun. Imagine going into a battle where you've just got a little pistol. Or one of the Nerf guns. Instead of your machine gun, we're going to talk about that in a second. Back in the day, it wasn't a machine gun, was it? It was what Melissa's drawn for us, a two-edged sword. A sword! The army. The army. He's bringing in the army. Those of you seen Cromwell. What's Cromwell's first name? Oliver, that was it, Oliver Cromwell. Good name. What do soldiers carry and what does it weigh? I asked Melissa today, I said, what do you weigh? She says, I don't know. That's how she talks, very posh. I said, we're going to ask your mother. So she goes to ask her mother. I think my mother was trying to fob me off. Oh, just say 30 kilos, he'll believe anything. So she comes back and says 30 kilos. Listen to this. We live in an age of unprecedented technology. Technology that makes our lives easier and more connected at the push of a touchscreen, glance of a monitor. For the military, ruggedized equivalents provide tactical awareness, allowing soldiers and marines to see beyond their personal sight using GPS, smartphones, tablets, and even helmet-mounted screens. Things have changed. Further advances in technology have produced better body armor, better weapon, optics and imaging devices, and a host of other specialized, productive and offensive gear. We've reached a point where the most significant limit of our soldiers is how much they can carry. Things have changed. If you look, you can get a, I'm sure you go on the internet and you see what it used to be like, all the different battles and warfare and what they used to dress like, the Roman soldier, and you come up to 2019, 2020, and see the difference in what they carry, their weapons, what they wear. The modern soldier's inventory. Today, the average US soldier carries at least 60 pounds of gear. Melissa weighs 4.7 stone. They carry 4.2 stone. They carry Melissa everywhere they go in battle. Imagine that. Cool man, wow, she's the right burden today, she is. They carry 4.2 stone with them. With an extended patrol, often doubling that weight. That's over 8 stone they carry if they're going on extended patrol. Specialized warfighters, automatic riflemen, combat medics, special operations can see totals much higher. Some of them carry 90 pounds a year, that's 6.4 stone. All the time they're carrying this stuff. Clothing, protective measures, body armor. I watched just a 6-minute video on just the soldier, what he carries. I won't go through it all today, but it's very interesting what they carry. The rucksacks. They have to carry 16 pounds worth of batteries. Because of all the equipment, the monitors, the iPhones, the GPS, all that stuff, they carry back. You don't see the backpacks they put on. Plus, you're talking body armor. Talk about bullet point and I can't remember the word begins with K that they're surrounded by now. Stop bullets going into it. Just what is it?
Kevlar.
That's it. Kevlar. Very. You're very, very good. Kevlar. That's it. I mean, you wouldn't believe it. And then you talk about, all the different stuff they carry. And this is all the technological stuff. It's incredible. That's before they even pick up their gun. Yeah? Man, I'd be shattered before I even got out the plane. You're having all that stuff. Then I was looking at the different weapons, right? And is it carbine or carbine?
Carbine.
I'll take that. Is the authority on there? Yeah? M4 carbine, what it can do. Talk about a versatile weapon. So they're lightweight, mobile and adaptable, can even be mounted with grenade launchers, automatic variants of the M4, just sniper weapon, M24, M240L. The weapons they use and carry, they weigh a ton. That's the modern day 2019, 2020 soldier. If you haven't got the right weapon, you haven't got the right gear, you go into battle unprepared, you get hammered. I mean, we're not talking about playing games. We're talking about life and death situations. If you're unprepared in your Christian life and you're going into battle and you're not prepared and you haven't got the right gear and you haven't got the right sword, weapon, you're getting hammered. There's so many Christians in such a state today because they're unprepared. They haven't got the right gear on. They talk about spiritual warfare. It makes me laugh, the Pentecostal, we're going to walk in the streets praying over all this stuff. With signs and wonders, speaking in tongues and healings and all this stuff. They haven't got a clue. They really haven't got a clue. And then when one thing happens, one bullet's fired by the enemy, they're straight into the woods, you never see them again. They get upset at church. These Christian soldiers get upset at church and they run straight back to the world. Somebody upsets them. Parks in their car park space. Says something nasty to them like, I don't think you should have said that. Then that's it. You never see him again. I mean, it's pathetic. You get offended so easy and you just run away. It's pathetic. You call yourself a Christian soldier. You're a joke. You're an absolute joke. Not even an action man. You know what? The guy we know, he's not where he should be, but he did make me smile. He called Salvation Army chocolate soldiers. It would be very good if, I don't know, it had national service, but especially for Christians, if every Christian had to go through a training thing of what the army has to go through, just so you can get the analogy of a soldier compared to what a Christian soldier should be like. 99.9% of Christians couldn't hack it. It's too tough. The Bible says, put on the whole armour of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. This is real. This is the word of God. This is scripture. Our only offensive weapon is the sword, which is the book, the Bible. If you got the wrong book, you got the wrong Bible, you got the wrong weapon, you're doomed. You got no chance. That's your Nerf gun. The NIV is a Nerf gun. You haven't got a chance. I've got New King James. You got a Nerf gun. Turn with me for a few verses. Hebrews chapter 4. If you haven't got a King James Bible, you haven't got the right weapon. You'll do no good. You talk about spiritual warfare, you haven't got a clue. You haven't got a chance. Hebrews 4 verse 12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The word of God. It's powerful, it says. Psalm 149 verse 6. That the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. You go out with the praises of God and a two-edged sword, the Bible. You're praising God, you got your Bible. You're ready for warfare. You put on the whole armour of God. Ephesians 6, we're just going to hit verse 17 and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. It's interesting, isn't it? Sword is word, the word, W-O-R-D, with an S on. Sword. The sword is the word. If you look at Hebrews 5 verse 13, imagine going into battle without training. It takes hours and hours and hours and hours of practice, of shooting. And if you're a swordsman or an archer, you don't just pick it up. You know, people are naturally skilled, but you don't just pick it up. You have to be trained. Hebrews 5, verse 13, says this. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. That's your hyperdipers, that's your Calvinists, that's your Fennies, that's all them nut jobs, breakers, all those nut jobs. Fighting among the ranks. It's just stupidity. They're not skilled in the word. They're unskilled. And they're fighting among themselves. They're babies. They're babes. It's madness. And if you haven't got the right Bible, you will achieve nothing in your Christian life. Nothing. Somebody once said this. This is so true. There has never been a revival since the 1611 came out that has been based on anything other than the King James Bible. There's never been a revival. Billy Graham only saw the masses coming to him on a King James Bible. Billy Sunday on a King James Bible. When you get rid of the King James Bible, you'll never see revival. Never. No matter what they say. NIVs, ESVs, whatever you call it. You'll never see a revival other than something on the King James Bible. And sadly, we're the day of small things now, preceding the rapture. There's not going to be any mass revival. But you'll see results today when you're basing your life and your doctrine on a King James Bible. Other than that, you're wasting your time. If you're going to a church that isn't King James, they're wasting their time. I know it's difficult, and sometimes it's the only place to go to, but you ought to do your best to make people aware of the differences. Look at Revelation 1. Turn to Revelation 1. Revelation 1, verse 16. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. His countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. The word of God. There's power in the word. The word, capital W, being the Lord Jesus Christ. The small W being the word of God, the written word. I'll see something else in a second. Revelation 19, verse 15. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. He treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. I love Ruckman's thing. Guess who's coming back, and boy is he mad. So true. You beat the lamb up, but you won't beat that lion. Revelation 2:16. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth, the word of God. Hosea 6, verse 5. Therefore have I hewed them by the prophets. I've slain them by the words of my mouth. All these great cross references. Back to Hebrews. We're talking about the word of God. The Bible, the King James Bible. Not versions or translations. We're talking about this Bible here, the King James Bible. Not other versions or translations. Nothing but the King James. They try and make you sound as if you're in a cult now. They would say anything. Let them say what they like. We've got what we've got here. We've got our weapon. Hebrews 11 verse 3. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. They were framed by the word of God. God spoke. God spoke. And everything came into being. The power in the word. Revelation 17:17. For God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will and to agree and give their kingdom unto the beast until the words of God shall be fulfilled. The word of God shall be fulfilled. You have a final authority. You know, I've had that Kingston Bible Trust come back on, didn't I? You know, saying, oh, I'm disappointed what you're saying about Darby's translation. Listen, Darby was a great bloke, but he messed up when he tried to produce his own Bible. He wasted his time. What a waste of time that was. Needless to say, we never heard from them again. Matthew 4:4. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Now, this is the final authority on all matters of faith and practice. This is everything. It all hinges on this. You've either got every word or you haven't. And I've got every word in Genesis to Revelation that God wants me to have in a King James Bible. That's my final authority. Now, if the first thing the devil did was attack the word of God, you can guarantee he's been doing it ever since. And Christians have been duped by this. The majority of them, the high 90% of Christians, have been duped that the Bible has been corrupted. They don't even know it. And so they're reading a corrupted translation or a corrupted version. They don't even know it. And they're not seeing these results. And they're not fighting with the right gun, the right sword, the right weapon. And it means nothing to them when you try and say, look, you ought to get rid of your Nerf gun and get yourself a M4 carbine machine gun with a grenade launcher. Well, they don't want it. They don't want to be told because of arrogance and pride. 2 Corinthians 2, verse 17. For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity, but as of God, in the sight of God, speak we in Christ. Not as many which corrupt the word of God. They were corrupting the word of God in Paul's day. Think what they're doing today. You've got 250 different translations of the Bible. If you're not reading the King James Bible, you're wasting your time. Your Christian life is all over the shop. You haven't got a clue. John 14, verse 23. Jesus answered and said unto him, If a man love me, he will keep my words, plural. Keep my words? Well, obviously the people in the NIV and ESV and New King James, all those, they obviously don't love the Lord Jesus Christ. They can't do, can they? When the NIV removes over 64,000 words, how can you be fulfilling that verse? If a man love me, he will keep my words. So if you haven't got the right equipment going into battle, you've got no chance. That's why when the Jehovah's Witnesses turn up, and you've got an NIV, they'll beguile you, because you've got the same Bible that's taken from their same manuscripts that they take their Bible from, man-made. You want the right Bible. That's the first thing. More than anything else, you get your foundation right, you get your Bible right, you get your weapon right. So go back to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11. Put on the whole armour of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Well, the first thing you want to do is get your gun, get your sword, get your weapon. You may not have the right clothing on at the moment. That will come. But get your weapon. Turn to Romans 13. You're going to stand against the wiles of the devil. Christians are being pushed all over the place today. They're falling short, they're backsliding, they're falling into sin and all kinds of things because they haven't got the right weapon. They're not in the book, they're not training, they're not a soldier. Romans 13, verse 12. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armour of light. Put on the whole armour of God. Get kitted out right. Be prepared for battle. Put on the whole armour of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. So you look at your own Christian life. And are you being pushed from pillar to post? You don't know even what day it is. You don't know where you're going in life. You're drifting. You don't know what the purpose is. You don't know where you should be. You don't even know if you're in the will of God. You're being pulled from pillar to post. Why? Have you got on the whole armour of God? Are you where you should be? Are you training? Put on the whole armour of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. 2 Corinthians 6, verse 7. By the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armour of righteousness on the right hand and on the left. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We looked at some of the things and we were talking about different sins, weren't we, last week when we said about the wiles of the devil. We weren't talking about the so-called big sins that we see. We're talking about the things in our characters, how we want to change things, our laziness. We don't read enough, we don't pray enough. We're not reaching the lost, we don't have a love and passion for the Lord or for lost souls. We're not really living as we should. Some of you took that to heart and you did something about it. And you tried harder this week. 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 8. But let us who are of the day, be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for an helmet, the hope of salvation. Breastplate of faith and love? What's your faith like? What's your faith in God like? The faith in the book. What's your love like? Have you put on the breastplate of faith and love? Or are you just a critical, cynical Christian attacking other Christians? Because you're jealous of what they're achieving, you're doing nothing with your life. You're not where you should be. What kind of Christian are you? 2 Corinthians 2, verse 11. Lest Satan should get an advantage over us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Satan gets an advantage over us because we are ignorant of his devices. Do you even know what some of Satan's devices are? Well, if you listened to the sermon last week, you'd know. We could spend page after page now, just writing down some of Satan's device, how he attracts you and distracts you throughout your life. We are told to put on the whole armour of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, lest Satan should get an advantage over us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Paul wasn't. And many Christians down through, of course we all get, you know, conned on occasions, tricked on occasions. But you're meant to be vigilant. You keep looking. Keep watch. And then he goes on to say, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Go back to Genesis 6. Right at the beginning. Right at the beginning, Genesis 6 verse 5. God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Right at the beginning, that's what it was like. So he wipes them out with a flood. There's coming a time when he's coming back again, and he's going to sort this world out once and for all. Because in every dispensation, it ends in failure, it ends in apostasy, it ends in man following after the devil. We just can't do it on our own. We need God. Every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continuing. How much worse is it today? You look around what's happening to our country today, to society, to what's happening to our children today, what they're being taught. If you take the weapon, the word of God, out of the schools, you're not giving them something to find. You don't teach them about absolutes, what's the final authority, what is right and what is wrong, and give them absolutes. And you're trying to make everything gender neutral, you're trying to make everything neutral. They haven't got a clue. They're so messed up in their minds that as they grow, each generation's getting worse and worse and worse. That's why it's declining at such a rapid pace. Preceding the rapture. It won't get better. I've said it before, this is the best day it's going to get. It's going to get worse and worse. Tomorrow's going to be even worse. But you're a soldier. And you may be on a little skirmish. You may be, you know, on your own, wherever you are, in the woods, in your wilderness, in your work, you know, fighting against your work colleagues, standing, trying to stand up for the Lord. And that's tough. You put on your armor of God. You're trying to love them the best you can. You're putting on your faith. You've got your shield of faith. Breastplate of righteousness, you're putting your helmet, you're taking a stand the best you possibly can. But it's tough. Because you've got masses and masses and masses of enemies. You stand up for the Lord, you're going to get people ridiculing you, you're going to get people after you. They're going to try and cause you problems. They're going to try and hurt you. And ultimately, it's Satan. He wants to destroy you. He's lost the war, he knows that, but the battles in your life, he wants you to fail. Because there's nothing worse in his eyes than a Christian on fire for the Lord who really loves the Lord Jesus Christ with everything and trying to please him and do the will of God. That's why some of your families don't get you. They don't understand you because you're trying to live for Jesus Christ. You want to be a true Christian soldier and they're not doing what they should be doing. They're jealous of what you're achieving and it makes them angry. And so they go against you. And they want you to compromise your faith. Put down your weapon. Take off your armor. Sit down. Relax. Listen, if there's ever a time to put on your armor, it's now. All the way until we see the captain of our salvation. Then afterwards you can lay it all down. But not now. It's fight now, rest later. Fight now, rest later. But a lot of Christians have got it the reverse. They think it's laziness and, oh, don't worry about it. It'll all work out. It'll pan out in the end. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And you get Christians want to talk about the Bilderbergs and the Illuminati and all this kind of stuff and say, listen, don't waste your time on that stuff. Sort out your own Christian life. You're fighting against the flesh. Get that, you know, get your mind right. Sort out your flesh. Get close to the Lord. Get the gospel out. And keep your head down. And stand your ground where you can. And be brave and ask God to give you courage and strength and get into the Word. Get skilled in the Word. 99.9% of Christians aren't skilled in the Word. Haven't got a clue. This is the weapon. They hardly ever pick it up. Maybe once a week they pick it up. They don't spend much time in it, so they're not skilled. And therefore their lives are all over the place. They drift. They're up and down. Like, one minute they're up, they're down. They just don't know where they're going. They're drifting through life. We're nearly through. Put on the whole armour of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Turn to Ephesians 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world. You don't anymore, or you shouldn't do unless you're a backslider. According to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. There's a spirit that works in them. Among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh. Are you doing that? And of the mind, are you doing that? And were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. We were like that. But sadly, as Christians, we're not on fire for the Lord anymore. And we keep, like a dog returns to its vomit, you keep running back. Rather than pushing on forward, like a soldier truly should, or standing your ground, you keep running back. And if you read John, we're not going to do it now, John chapters 14, 16, Daniel 9 to 11. And then, of course, that great verse, 2 Corinthians 4, 4. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4, in whom the God of this world, small g, the devil, hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Oh, there's so much in that verse. The God of this world, he blinded the minds of them. All those people that are not saved, your family members that are not saved, they've been blinded by the devil. Sure, it's true we fight against principalities, powers, rulers of darkness. Ultimately, it is Satan who's created all these problems, this sin that people are fighting against. And as I say, fighting against, embracing a lot of them. All these sins, the television, all this new stuff, this sexual stuff, everywhere you look. Trying to corrupt. Be careful what you watch. Be careful what you listen to. Be vigilant. Be watchful. Stand your ground. As a true soldier of Jesus Christ. Be careful what you let your children get involved with. Put on the whole armour of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. We will pick up again from verse 13. Again, picking up in regard to the whole armour. Lord willing, next time. It should be a challenge to all of us to just again evaluate where we are in life, what we're doing, what we're achieving. Whether we are really on fire for the Lord, whether we really are a true Christian soldier, or one of these that gets so easily offended, we're not achieving much in life. And therefore we're not walking godly in Christ Jesus, but we're very worldly and carnal. And we put business and careers and all that stuff above the will of God. Let's pray.